Well, it begins with the history of humans.
Strength competitions have probably been around as long as humans have walked the earth. History has stories from all over the world about lifting some sort of object as either a training tool or a test of prowess. If there was something heavy lying around, then there was probably some sort of contest to lift it, carry it, or throw it. And some of these ancient tools are still around in some form or another, often being used in modern tests of muscle, sweat, and pain. Hi, I'm Chip Conrad, and this is the History of Weightlifting.
The Arnold Sports Expo this year, in a side room off the beaten path away from the crowded, loud expo floor, was a smaller room of spectators watching the modern version of one of the oldest sports in the world. Weightlifting is a battle between man or woman and gravity, which requires a speed and athleticism that is completely unique. No other style of training will prepare you for it. Yet, using the techniques of weightlifting will help you prepare for just about anything else.
This type of training carries over into so many things better than anything else. I mean, if you can snatch and clean and jerk, and that's part of your, then you can do any other sport better.
It could be any sport, even for like in high school sports, basketball, volleyball, football. Even for older people, even just doing the barbell, it helps them with balance, kinesthetic awareness.
Now, as a strength and conditioning coach, snatches and clean and jerks and squats are the best thing for these kids to do. It's functional movements, multiple joint movement exercise, full range of motion, on their feet.
Like the first month, I went from like a 19-inch vertical to like maybe 25, 26 inches. And then from there, I got about a 30-inch vertical now, and it's been working really well for me.
This just really seemed like the full package. Your balance, all your muscle groups working together, your coordination, your flexibility, your speed, your timing, your power, and every bit of mental focus that you could have.
Although not an organized sport until the late 1800s, lifting heavy objects as a personal or community challenge is ancient. In fact, through the mid-1900s, a common term for the sport of weightlifting was halterophilia, which was a term derived from the Greek weights called halteres, or throwing weights. Although not used for competitive lifting, these might be considered the first documented dumbbells. And even in several thousand years, the design has not been modified a heck of a lot. Eventually, and fairly recently as far as things go, the barbell became the dominant tool in strength competitions, and the most internationally recognized strength contest is now the sport of weightlifting.
So where did the barbell come from?
Heavy sticks, or weighted poles, have probably been used for training in some form or another throughout history. Champion powerlifter and physical culture historian Jan Todd quotes the French essayist Michel Montaigne, who wrote about his father as someone who actively pursued strength through regular training, quote, with hollow staves, filled with lead, which he was wont to use and exercise his arms withal.
That was written almost 500 years ago, and wasn't the only account of weight training from the time period. In 1531, English scholar Sir Thomas Eliot advised exercising by lifting and throwing the heavy stone or bar.
As gyms evolved, so did the equipment. The Turnplatz of Germany in the early 1800s were outdoor athletic centers which focused on gymnastics and calisthenics. The idea to move indoors eventually led to workout centers that started to resemble what we today might recognize as a gym. The big gyms of the 1800s, like Hippolyte Triat's Gymnase Triat or Edmond Debonnet's School of Physical Culture, would have gymnastic rings, climbing ropes, Indian clubs, and dumbbells. And exercise was often taught in group formats, precluding modern aerobics classes and CrossFit by a century and a half. A lightweight pole, often referred to as a wand, was common in these gyms, and according to some documents, had been around since at least 100 years prior. Eventually, this wand morphed into what Madame Brenner, owner of a women's gymnasium in Britain, called a barbell, which was, according to her, a cross between a wand and a French dumbbell, which seemed to be a hybrid dumbbell-wand combo being used by the French military and upper-class schools at the time. So, the barbell-wand-French-dumbbell thing evolved into a weighted stick with globes on each end. Eventually, these globes got bigger, thanks to the strong men and women of the time who wanted heavier toys to play with, and due to the ideas of a Boston strongman named George Barker Winship. Winship, who invented the loadable dumbbell in 1859, also brought the concept of plate loading to the world with an adjustable dumbbell, which he patented in 1865, called the Practical Graduating Dumbbell. $16 got you an adjustable strength tool that could be loaded up to 101 pounds in half-pound increments. That's innovative even by today's standards.
And then competitive weightlifting started getting going in the middle 1800s, because they used to have a lot of strongman acts. And so then some strongmen would say, well, yeah, they'd come up with, I'm the strongest man in the world, then somebody would challenge them, and they all had different implements that they lifted, and different ways of calling themselves the strongest man in the world, kind of like today.
Strength competitions at this point were far from the organized weightlifting competitions of today. Strongmen would challenge each other one-on-one, like a boxing match or a duel, and their mano-a-mano competitions were popular entertainment of the time. The two men battling against each other would simply pick the lifts and pick the tools. The challenge might be lifting platforms full of people with their backs or legs, or shouldering a massive bag of grain weighing more than two average men. This made every contest unique and quite a sight to behold. Eventually, though, organized strength competitions began to emerge, and the barbell became the star of the show. Although heavy barbells wouldn't be a trend in America until Alan Calvert founded Milo Barbell Company in 1902, the rest of the world was starting to get the iron bug. Following Germany's lead, where weightlifting clubs began to emerge as early as 1878, Vladislav Krajewski founded the St. Petersburg Amateur Weightlifting Society, and then, in 1891, the German Athletic Association was formed for weightlifters, holding its first competition in Cologne in 1892. But let's not get the idea that these early competitions resembled the sport today. If we use the beginning of the modern Olympics as a gauge, the sport of weightlifting was still a bit, chaotic. A two-handed barbell lift, which was an early version of the clean and press, as demonstrated in this video from 1971, with 502 pounds. Was the one consistent lift from the first Olympic Games of 1896 onward, until it was eliminated as a contested lift in 1972, but we'll get to that. But that was the only consistency in the early games.
So keep in mind, every Olympics that offered weightlifting kept the two-handed barbell lift, but there were other lifts that changed and shifted over the years.
The 1896 Olympics also featured a one-arm dumbbell lift, which was probably equivalent to the one-arm snatch.
By the way, there was a tie for first place on the two-handed lift, and the chosen winner was a Mr. Jensen, who defeated a Mr. Elliott because he showed better form.
1900, no weightlifting. The 1904 Olympics had a 9-lift dumbbell contest, with an option for a 10th lift if you wanted bonus points. The lifts were lowering a pair of dumbbells from overhead to straight out in front of you, a one-arm curl, a one-arm snatch from the ground, a one-arm jerk from the shoulder, and a strict press with a dumbbell in each hand.
And that was day one. Day two consisted of
dumbbell curl with each arm at the same time, dumbbell clean from the ground, a one-arm press, two-hand dumbbell jerk from shoulders, and an optional lift for bonus points. Points were given for first, second, and third place with each lift, but there's no account of how much weight was actually lifted. The intercalated games of 1906 are no longer recognized by the IOC as official Olympic games, yet they might have saved the sagging popularity of the Olympics at the time. Although this was a failed attempt to hold the Olympic Games every 2 years, these games did introduce many of the Olympic protocol that are considered standard today, such as the formalities of the opening and closing ceremonies. The weightlifting, like the 1896 Olympics, featured the two hands lift and the one hand lift. This would be the last year weightlifting made it into the Olympics, well, sort of the Olympics, for another 14 years. But international competitions were still on the rise, and the sport was gaining momentum.
It was primarily organized in Italy and Germany and Austria-Hungary and Prussia, you know, all the Eastern Europeans were the big ones into the organizing strength competitions. So, because the IWF, the International Weightlifting Federation, didn't really get going until they called their official day 1905.
So this popularity of weightlifting, with the help of the IWF, made the 1920 Olympics pivotal. After a sketchy relationship with the Olympic Games until this point, weightlifting was officially, now and forever, an Olympic sport.
This was also the first Olympics to introduce weight classes, although not quite the same as they are today. Up until that point, the strongest lift won, period.
The three lifts this year were the one-hand snatch, the one-hand clean and jerk, and the two-hands clean and jerk. 1924 featured a five-lift competition, three of those lifts with two hands. This was the last year of the shot-filled globe barbell, which the lifters could choose over the newer, popular, plate-loaded Berg revolving sleeve barbell. But only the French team chose the globe bells, and with them they took home two gold medals. Since then, the revolving sleeve, or Olympic barbell, has become a staple not only in weightlifting competitions, but in every gym in the world.
The bar that you throw around your local athletic center doesn't differ a heck of a lot from the one created by Caspar Berg over 80 years ago.
Finally, in 1928, the three lifts that were to become the official sport of weightlifting for the next 40 years were chosen. The press, the clean and jerk, and the snatch. All with two hands, and all with a barbell.